Okay, thanks for joining us today, everyone. Welcome to the Forestry Adaptation Practitioner Network webinar on climate change adaptation in Harib Proctor Community Forest. My name is Brooke Tasama, and I'm one of the facilitators of this online practitioners network, which is run by us here at the Climate Risk Institute. I'm here today with my colleague, Claire Sanders, who will be in the back end to provide support if needed. And if at any time during the webinar you have questions or experience technical difficulties, click on the chat box and you can find our names in the drop-down menu of participant to send us a direct message. And if you can't see our names, you can also send a message to the hosts and panelists in the chat box. So just to let you know, we are recording the webinar today and we'll be sending out a copy of the recording along with the slides to those who have registered at the end of the webinar. Before we go any further, I would like to gratefully acknowledge that I'm currently located on the traditional and unceded territory of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabeg, and Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. Indigenous peoples have long modeled sustainable forest management and land stewardship practices. And at the Climate Risk Institute, we are continually trying to improve both our knowledge, processes, and relationships so that we can highlight and integrate Indigenous perspectives and knowledge of climate change into our work. And I invite you all to introduce yourself and share the territories you're joining us from today in the chat if you'd like. But that being said, we're very excited to have our speaker here today, Eric Leslie. Eric is a forestry consultant and manager of the Harib Proctor Community Forest near Nelson, BC. He has worked with the forestry industry, Indigenous people, community organizations, and regional and provincial governments on projects from Haida-Gwaii to Labrador. Eric, he has extensive experience in forestry planning and operations, community engagement, and small business management. And for the past decade, his work has focused on community-based strategies to address climate change and reduce wildfire risks. So on behalf of everyone joining us, I'd like to extend a very welcome to you, Eric, for taking the time and presenting for us today. So without further ado, I will turn things over to you to begin the presentation.
Super. Thank you, Brooke. Thanks, Claire. It's great to be here. I'm in Nelson, BC. I'm on the traditional territories of the Tanaha, the Sinaiks, and the Silks peoples. And the burning and other management activities that they've done on the land here for many, many centuries is a big part of the story of climate change here. And I'll just say briefly, like, I am a forestry consultant. I work for a number of different clients. But my most longstanding work has been with the Harib Proctor Community Forest, where I've been the forest manager for 16 years. So I'm gonna be speaking with you about the work that I've been doing for past 5 or 10 years in the community forest. And hopefully we can get a bit of a conversation going. So I'm gonna share my screen here. There we go. I'm assuming you can see my screen now, my title slide. Super, thanks. Okay, like I said, I'm a forestry consultant, I'm a forester, and I manage this community forest. I'll introduce that in a moment. So here is the community forest, in the blue circle in the southeastern part of BC, not too far north from the US border. We're a couple valleys west of the Rockies, east of the Okanagan. Here we are zoomed in a bit more. The pink outline is the community forest. We're on the shores of Kootenai Lake and we're surrounded by a provincial park, which is not shown on the map, but you can see it to the south and the west, and then the city of Nelson down in the left-hand corner. Okay, very briefly, our community forest, it's around 11,000 hectares and change. It runs all the way from the private land boundary, which is just above lake level, up to the tops of the mountains, as you can see in this photo here. We're lucky enough to manage entire watersheds right to the height of land. And hydrology is a big issue in our area. Our forests almost entirely originated from major fires in the early 1900s associated with settlement and the railways and a lot of lightning fires as well during that time. So our forests are in that 120-year-old age group for the most part. And of course, fire has been excluded from our landscape until recently anyways, for many years. Here's a visual of the headwaters of one of our creeks, just showing continuous mature forest. There's some spots of red in there showing, this is actually a 15-year-old photo showing mountain pine beetle starting to act up. And you can see the dense forest types that we have, the inset. We have had two major wildfires in the past 20 years, both burned into Harrop Creek, which is a 4,000 hectare watershed, and have had a significant impact on the creek. That's just a preview of things to come here. The co-op is manages the community forest. It's a not-for-profit. We've been around for over 22 years, and we're a community forest in BC. You can look up community forests in BC. There are over 50 community forests operating in BC. We are one of them. We were the second community forest to be created in the province. We're a grassroots organization with over 200 members. There are only 600 residents in Harrop Proctor, so that's a pretty large membership ownership from the community. And our objectives are ecosystem-based forestry, local employment, and in the last decade, a couple of decades, we've added wildfire protection and climate change. Okay, this project, there's lots of talk about climate change and lots of ideas about what to do, but I don't see in the forestry sector all that much action on the ground yet, even though it's been many years of talking. So this disconnect is what I see as needing to be addressed, and many others also see as needing to be addressed. So this is a real world example of climate change adaptation on the ground. So we hear lots of general guidance for how to manage ecosystems and forests in the context of a changing climate. As you'll see in the left-hand side, promote resilient species, et cetera. But we don't get a lot, in my experience, of really specific, okay, here's a land base, here's a watershed, here's a stand. What are we going to do exactly here? So that's what this project is about. We have an advisory committee. I won't run through everybody who's on the advisory committee, but we do have ecologists and foresters and biologists and government people and industry people on the committee that has been advising me over the years that I've been implementing this project. Okay, there are a couple premises, starting points. This is not a science project, or we're not doing anything new. Here, in terms of science, we are doing application. There's already enough science out there to get going. Here we just see an example of stream flows that have already changed significantly, spring and fall over the past 40 years. Spring flows are way up, summer flows, late summer flows are way down in a watershed very similar to ours. So the changes are already visible. And this is, in a really simple way, the starting point from the climate modeling and reality that I'm working with. You know, warmer fall, winter, and spring, likely a bit wetter, but summer's quite a bit warmer and significantly drier on average, which not surprisingly leads to more average annual area burned, as the graphs will show. For the past 20 years in BC, we're seeing a real sort of hockey stick kind of situation as far as fires and extreme events of all kinds, including precipitation events. So that's where we're starting. We're not going backwards to re-examine this information. This is pretty solid. We also have a lot of high-level direction as to how we might adapt from ecologists, from senior government people. I was just looking at this slide this morning and realized every one of these reports is 10 or more years older, or nearly. And yet there's not that much to point to on the ground. Another reason to do this work. Okay, so that's the second premise. We already have enough high level direction as to the kinds of things we need to be doing. The other thing is that in the community forest, the values haven't changed. We're still managing for these four main values, And climate change doesn't change the values that we're managing for, but it just does change the way in which we can do that or try to do that. Okay, so the project, what is it? Involves three main components. One's a risk assessment, which I'll run through quickly in a moment. Another is a specific operations strategy. And the other involves management planning and harvest level analyses. So where do we adapt, how do we adapt, and how fast do we adapt are the three questions we're working on. Concrete questions from a management perspective. Okay, risk assessment. It's a classic type of risk assessment, probability and consequence, and it's about prioritizing actions for the next 20 to 40 years, starting now, or starting a few years ago, actually. So I'm gonna run through that a little bit. This is a bit of a messy slide. I wasn't usually gonna put it on, but some people say they like it. If conceptualize the project, you start with the values that we're managing for, what are the risks to the value from climate change, where do those risks come from, and then how might we address those risks. That's sort of the logic, the flow in the project. Values mapping. This is the consequence side. I won't run through how this work is done, but we have mapped where the water values are in our community forest, generally high elevation headwaters areas. You look at where the water values are, and then you look at where the timber values are. There are almost in opposite places in the land base. So we can't just take all the values and smash them together and say, how should we adapt without identifying which values we're managing for? Probability now. So fire and drought, so the other side of the risk equation. We looked at moisture regimes in the community forest. This is where the climate modeling comes in. Don't worry too much about the details here. Just know that this comes from the provincial ecologist and regional ecologist. And looking, the green is wet and red is dry. And the upper line is the past climate and the next line down paired is the future climate, and we can see how much drier it's going to get. Of course, even if we get a bit more moisture, or even a moderate amount more moisture, the temperatures are going up enough that the drought will be much more, especially on the drought prone sites that are already out there. So here's the past climate. 1990 climate and our land base from a soil moisture perspective, 1990, 2055, 2085. If you know the mountains around here, none of that will be terribly surprising, but there are some interesting things there around certain valleys that are coarse textured soils and how much more droughty they are getting. Okay, on the probability side, we look at the species and their tolerance to drought. Each species has its own tolerance. And of course, as things get droughty, they might fall off the bottom end of their range. So drought probability is another thing that we've mapped. We can get into that if anyone has questions later. Fire probability, we did not use the provincial algorithm. It was not useful for our forest types. We had to develop our own, and adjusting the fuel types for slope and dead pine and balsam and for cedar hemlock. This is the map we end up with as far as fire probabilities. Remember, we've had all these decades of fire exclusion, almost entirely coniferous forest, 100 plus years old, there's high fire risk, and of course even higher in the future. I think we all know about that. Now, summary of our risk assessment. This is just one map. So I have done what I said you shouldn't do, which is smash all the values together and all the probabilities together into one map. But it's still helpful to illustrate where we have the highest priority areas to try to do some adaptation work. It tends to be closer to the community. The north or the upper part of this slide is low elevation, and the upper part is the high elevation. Okay, triage, that's one of the metaphors that I think of when I'm thinking about climate change adaptation. There's very much to do or to worry about, but we can only do so many things. So let's pick the top priorities that we can actually do something about. So we're looking at working in relation to homes on the drier areas near homes. No surprise there. Headwaters areas with high fire likelihood are areas that we might want to protect from a water perspective. That's harder to do given our land base, but that's still a high risk area. Timber obviously is the higher value timber on the drier sites are where we're most at risk. So that's where we should be working if we can. Okay, moving on to our operation strategy. This is where it gets really a lot more concrete. And I like to split the strategies that we have between sort of resistance-oriented strategy, which sort of means protecting what we have, and for example, trying not to have the community burn down or headwaters burn down, and then the realignment-related strategies, which are more about transitioning forest to the new and future climate. So you see on the left some of the kinds of strategies you can use if you're resisting, and then on the right, in red, some of the strategies you can use if you're realigning. And of course, these are actually happening at the same time, potentially in adjacent, immediately adjacent areas. So that's key concept. Okay, carbon and mitigation of climate change as well as adaptation. Again, this resist, realign concept is very helpful, I find. June 2003 was when, I believe, in the West Armacootney Lake, the maximum amount of carbon, at least above ground carbon, I think carbon in any manner, that's when maximum carbon and maximum conifer was reached in our area. That's just before the mountain pine beetle hit, and that's just before wildfire returned in a big way. So we've already been going downhill on carbon, and with the dynamic ecosystems that where fire's a big player, we can't expect to hold carbon on the land base everywhere. And we can't resist everywhere. We have to realign in some places. So we're talking about managing a transition here, and short-term and long-term approaches might be quite different. This is our net downs map. It shows the areas that are reserved in our community forest. So a key starting point to recognize is that pretty much all of the upper elevations from a forest management or timber perspective are reserved because of headwaters or caribou habitat or inoperable land all around. That's a starting point. So here we are. This is basically my work plan in many ways to develop a network of fuel treatments above the community at the lower elevations right up against private land, which you could see in that those series of straight purple lines there. That's the private land boundary. And you can also see the wildfires that have burned into our community forest, and all the dots, purple are fire origin, I mean, human origin fires, and the red dots are lightning origin fires over the past 50 years. All the dots are fires that were generally put out as an initial attack, and just the two of them got away. This is just a zoom in showing how we're working on a number of fuel breaks and some are done, some are in progress. We have machine guards, we have hand guards, we have many different approaches to reducing wildfire risk. This is a fairly obvious adaptation strategy around fire, kind of is in our faces all the time. We had a wildfire in 2017. I worked on it for 6 weeks, laying out machine guards and liaising with the community. The community was on evacuation alert in 2017 for a couple weeks, as it was indeed on alert in 2003. And the green guard there was actually constructed over Labor Day weekend in 2017 from three different headings. That's a 5 kilometer, 6 kilometer, 7 kilometer guard there. The yellow line was the ribbons that I hung if the green line didn't hold, and we had to run bulldozers behind everyone's house. Luckily, that didn't happen. So we got a head start on fire guards close to the community, but we also have to look at the rest of the community. So what are we doing? We're reopening one or two old roads in the community to provide access in advance of a fire, because that's usually the first thing that needs to be done when you, if there's a fire, if there's no access, there's no ability to manage it. We've reopened a couple of helipads, before we actually even need them, because that's the kind of land base that we have. Access is a big issue. Just a picture here of a couple of the machine guards that were put in during the wildfire in 2017. The guard is just 5 meters wide, is the width of an excavator, basically. You can lay a hose down, you can put crew on it. You can see in the arrow there, machine guard, I don't know how well it's visible here, but right here, I'm just going to get my highlighter here. Right in here was where that machine guard was built, and this forest is all burned up here, down here at, near the community. It didn't burn. Just an aerial view of one of the fire guards. They are varying in width, and there's a permanent road in the middle of them. This is a view from the ferry going over to Harrop. This area here has all had a partial cut fuel treatment in it. And this area up here is part of a landscape level fuel break. So we've got to connect up the treatments in order to reduce the risks. Okay, realignment, moving away from fire protection specifically and looking more at our low elevation ecosystems, especially. Here's an old growth Douglas fir tree, several hundred years old. It survived several fires, undoubtedly. It's, you know, it's over a meter in diameter. And here is a bunch of 60, 70, 80 year old cedar that's grown up since the last fire. So clearly there's something going on here in terms of the past forest and the future forest and what's realistic, what's appropriate. So realignment, here's a very typical low elevation stand right adjacent to Barry and Ursula's house in Harrop, as you can see in the photo inset there. Right up against the community, and it's a 100-year-old forest. There's Douglas fir in there, which you can see with a blue ring on it, a whole bunch of cedar hemlock ingrowth. And with the forest, with the climate changing, the cedar and the hemlock is just not viable edaphically, or not viable from a drought perspective on this site going forward. So what do we do about that? Well, we look at what our realignment options are. And we look at what are our desired future conditions. So don't worry about the details here about the codes, ICHDW, that just means interior cedar hemlock forest, dry warm subzone, and a submesic site within that. Looking at the kind of species we want to promote, what kind of densities we want, what kind of fuels we want, what kind of forest structure we want to manage for, and targets for how much to do in how long. This is in one slide. My plan for a significant portion of these kinds of sites through managing the forest, managing densities, and managing species, that sort of thing. Here's how it looks on the ground. There's an excavator working, hoe-chucking a lot of dying fir and cedar and hemlock to thin the stand out. This is about a 60%. Overstory removal, maybe even 70% of basal area, and leaving the big fir and larch where they exist. This is a year later. We've done piling and burning. We've got now canopy closures more in the range of 20 or 30%. This photo might even be a bit lower, but we've retained a lot of the most drought and fire tolerant trees. This is again just in behind private land in Harrop. Here is a stand about 10 years after we partial cut logged it. This was cable logging actually in Harrop Creek, a lot of dead pine. You can see in the inset there, just an example of one of the hundreds of thousands of pine that died in the community forest about 15 years ago. We took out a lot of that dead dying pine and again some cedar and hemlock and left the big fir and larch, and that's sort of more of a desired future condition or a more climate friendly condition that forest has been managed towards in this cut block. Reintroducing fire, obviously that's a big factor, big thing we need to be doing. We haven't introduced any major prescribed fire in the Hare Proctor land base. It just hasn't been safe to do so given our fuel densities, but I have worked on plans in an adjacent community forest, a nearby community forest that I also work for in the Slocan Valley. We have done a series of prescribed burns in the spring to reduce fine fuel loads in that area, dry south-facing slopes. You can see some of the forest structure there, ponderosa pine, Doug fir, with ingrowth of Douglas fir mostly. Also post this area here that is not part of the timber harvesting land base. This is an area of pure ecosystem restoration related work that's too steep to do any machine-based work on. This is an area that in West Arm Provincial Park that I was involved in writing a prescription and working with the Wildfire Service to burn the harvest slash from the partial cut and make the area more resilient. Very briefly, I've also worked on stocking standards for our district, both partial cut stocking standards, which mean we don't have an actual regeneration obligation on a dry site such as this. This is actually in Whitlaw Creek, I believe. Partial cut stocking standards, so we're not reforesting to high densities again in areas that can't support high densities. Again, in areas that are not partial cut and you can't necessarily successfully partial cut like you see in the top right there. There's a lot of cedar and hemlock in there, not a lot of big old fire or drought tolerant trees remaining. We're often opening those stands up quite a bit more and planting ponderosa pine and encouraging deciduous and spacing out the conifers. Again, this is a realignment activity. Finally, last step is looking at management plan and annual cut. So this is the how fast, how much issue. So we're redoing our timber supply review for our community forest. Having obviously to change the assumptions around losses to beetle and fire and growth rates are also changing. And we need to reconsider whether a supposed 250 year even flow harvest is really, well, it was always a bit of a stretch to bordering on ridiculous to talk about. But now the past doesn't predict the future. So we have to decouple from that notion, in my view, on small land bases. So that work is just in progress right now. And finally, we have outreach ongoing. We've developed a series of educational films that are on our community forest website and posted on YouTube about community wildfire protection and the link to climate change. I also do a number of presentations such as this one to different groups, and there's a handbook forthcoming. We just haven't finished the final documentation, but that will be released coming down the road, which will document how we've gone about this project, like I've outlined for you at sort of lightning speed here. Obviously, this is 5 years of work that I'm presenting in 20 minutes here. And with that, I will say thank you. And I hope that we can have some time for a Q&A. And I will be looking forward to your questions. So I'll stop sharing here and we can go into that part of the discussion.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Eric, that was excellent. And yeah, enjoy your presentation. And I particularly like the many visuals and photographs you had to really show what the work that you do and the work in action, and especially also the maps, the fire hazard mapping and probability mapping. Yeah, those were really cool. So yeah, now we have about 20 minutes left for some questions. So again, if you'd like to use the chat box, feel free to put your questions down there and type your questions there, but you can also raise your hands and we can unmute you and you can ask your question verbally. So both options are available.
Yeah, and I know I went very quickly through all of that. There's a lot of technical stuff in there, a lot of examples, but I wanted to go fairly quickly through the material in order to give time for discussion, because I know we have people from different parts of the province, from different parts of the country, and wanted to keep some time open for this discussion.
And just to jump in quickly, Eric, again, people are welcome to put up their hands. I already see one. We do have a question in the Q&A box, which Brooke will pass over to you. I put your website in the chat box, but if there are other resources that come up, please feel free to pass them over, and we're happy to get them into the practitioner space so everybody can have a look at them too.
Okay. I will do that. I will be posting some links on the practitioner in the space. Fabulous.
Okay, we can start with the question from the Q&A. It's from Colin Rankin. He said that he's interested in hearing more about the provincial fire probability mapping / modeling and why and how you adapted the community forests.
Yeah, so we have, British Columbia has what's called the Provincial Strategic Threat Analysis, PSTA, which provides a literally provincial level view of where the higher risk areas are, or attempts to show that. The reasons we didn't use that data, that data is widely available. The reason we found that we couldn't use that is that there's two main issues. One is that the fuel types that are in the Canadian fire modeling system, none of them are a good match to the kind of fuel types that we have in our part of the province. So that's a huge problem right there, that we can't model fire intensities and behavior very easily by just plugging in fuel types, which are largely based on boreal forest types. So that's one issue. And the other issue is that the forest cover inventory, or the vegetation resources inventory data that's used to, where the algorithm comes from, or the algorithm that models what the fuel types are, comes from an analysis of the forest cover data. And it's the data that we have, or that the province has, is very poor in terms of, it's just delinked between what they see in the inventory data and what the actual fuels are like on the ground. So we had to basically start from scratch. We used the provincial data and we checked how well it anticipated what actually burned in 2017. And unfortunately, the reality is that it was actually almost the opposite of the stands that were provincially modeled as high intensity fire likelihood didn't burn very hot, and the areas that weren't modeled burned hotter on average. So obviously we had to start again. So we didn't even adapt it. We sort of built it up from scratch, which on a small land base where provincial data doesn't work, you're kind of left doing that. But every land base will be different on that. If you're in the boreal forest, for example, you might be able to use provincial models much easier.
Great, thanks, Eric. And Colin, if you had any follow-up questions to that, don't hesitate to put up your hand and I can certainly unmute you. We do have somebody that I'm gonna just click allow to talk. Colin, you can feel free to unmute and go ahead and ask your question.
Hi, Colin Monty, research climatologist with the Ministry of Forest.
Hey, Colin.
Eric, great presentation. And I was intrigued by your call for a paradigm shift away from the even flow timber supply management. And I'd like to hear your, expanding on those thoughts. And particularly what that might look like in the community forest context, what the alternative would be, but also even if you have thoughts on larger scales, like at the timber supply area scale.
Yeah, that's a great question. And the answer for our community forest and for a regional provincial scale are going to be quite different, I think. It's important to point out to those who don't know that our community forest is a tiny, tiny little area relative to even the Kootenays. And we have a long-term area-based tenure, which we have the rights and responsibilities to manage in theory and perpetuity. So we have a lot of responsibility on this small piece of land. How the decoupling of the supposed straightish line of even flow future timber supply, how that looks on our land base? Well, it can look a number of different ways. But what I would say is that we already reached peak carbon and peak conifer 20 years ago. And that's the direction that it's going to be going in the future. So there will be in 20, 40, 60 years, in my view, fewer dense coniferous stands in our land base, regardless of what we actually do. One fire, the 2017 fire, burned more in a few days than we have touched with our logging in 20 years. So in one fire can essentially wipe out our whole community forest timber supply. So that's the context, which is very different, very scale dependent. So what it looks like for us is looking what our desired condition is, and if our desired future is in 10 years to have a fuel break behind Harrison Proctor and a couple of landscape level breaks in place, and if it's going to take cutting some more trees in the short term to achieve that, and that on balance is the best approach, then maybe we should do that. So that might, in our land base, look at increasing the cut in the short term. In other land bases, which are more heavily cut over or more heavily burned, or more heavily impacted, the actual implication might be very different. But that's our specific land base. On the provincial level, it's a much harder question to answer, because when you try to put everything at a provincial level, you lose a lot of the specificity of these sub-regional situations. So I don't know if I'm going to speak as, I just think I'm going to say that past doesn't predict the future anymore. That's what timber supply has generally been based on, and what we should, and you know this, and what we need to be doing is running multiple scenarios for our timber supply, and we need to be explicit about what the assumptions are and what the values are that we're prioritizing, and then picking among those scenarios as to what we think is the best bet, explicitly, not just stuffing a bunch of data into a black box saying this is what the timber supply is and doing that, because I think that's ignoring reality. We can talk more afterwards as well, Colin.
Yeah, thanks, Eric. We have another question in the Q&A from Janet Lane. And she said, you indicated that the current wood flow was not practical and maybe had never been practical on such a small land base. The low stocking and evolving to fire resistant species might not be a wood flow positive change. Is this a heads up for the forest industry?
Is this a heads up for the forest industry?
Yes, that's the question.
Yes, I think so. I think that timber supply and from a climate change perspective and cutting trees from a community forest perspective is a means to an end. And the ends are defined by the values that we're managing for. One of those values, yes, is jobs. And we have a small mill in the community. But we have other priorities as well. Wildfire protection, drinking water, that sort of thing. And if we're going to manage for those values in a changing climate in a fire-prone ecosystem, then we just have to accept that there's going to be lower stocking in the future, whether we initiate that ourselves or nature does. And yes, that does mean in the longer term, I think that the in this part of the province, the harvest level will be coming down for that reason, whether we like it or not. So we can take that reality and work with it, or we can stick our heads in the sand, but I don't think we can. Obviously, you know which side of that I come down.
Okay. Yeah, thanks, Janet, for that question. And if you have a follow-up, feel free to add it in the chat as well. Matthew Shields asks, do you find you need to spend a lot of effort on public outreach / explaining the rationale for plans? Or is the community generally aware and supportive of adaptive management?
Yeah, great question. We do spend a lot of time having these discussions in the community. It's a smallish community. Most of the people who are interested in forestry and land management, I've been able to meet them and talk with them over the past 16, 18 years. And because the community has to a large measure, the control, or as much control as anybody has over the decisions on the land base, it completely changes the conversation about what should and shouldn't be done in people's watersheds, because it's the people who are living in the watersheds are the owners of the business. So there's a very direct link between, like, I report to the board. The board are volunteers who are elected by the community. The community are the owners. So there's a direct link there. That's the context from a governance perspective. From what does it look like on the ground perspective? We have meetings. We have tours. I've given some simpler versions of some of this information in community presentations. The wildfire piece is really what's, I think, drives community interest, and the fact that we've had, you know, major wildfires and smoke many summers recently means that everybody is aware that the climate is changing, the world is changing, fire is happening. So there's a lot of engagement through the fire piece, and I think it's pretty well known now about the link between climate change and fire. So the engagement, I'd say, is pretty strong, and the level of support is very strong. If we had not had any wildfires yet in our community forest, I think that the support would not be as strong, but people have seen everybody, even if they don't pay attention normally. You can't miss the evacuation alert and the smoke in your face. So in our community, there's strong support overall.
That's great. I'll just jump in quickly, Brooke. And there was a follow-up question on the modeling, fire probability modeling, just asking about or interested in discussion about use of landscape level fuel breaks, cost and effectiveness versus or relative to fire guards. And this is maybe something we can also put in the practitioner space and get input from others on as well. So maybe we'll also flip it over there. But if you have a couple of thoughts, and then there's one more question in the Q&A box after that too.
Okay, so yeah, you saw pictures of fire guards, which are literally just 5 meters wide. And those were built in an emergency situation. And that's as wide as you're gonna get in that kind of a situation. And they're a lot better than nothing, to say the least. A landscape level fuel break is usually got a thin forest, low fuels area, tied into some access. So it might be 50, 100, 200, 300 meters wide. That's gonna be much more effective. It's not possible for us physically to do that throughout our watersheds, but where we can, we do believe that's the right thing to do. And they're generally on ridges, or they are on ridges, gentle ridges, and they're the most strategic location we can have. So sometimes we might just start with a access point. Everything starts with access, and then we try to broaden from there. So and yes, that also has that is done through timber harvesting. That also has long-term timber harvesting, timber supply impacts, because we're not trying to regenerate dense conifers on those stands. And that's part of our timber supply work as well. I hope that answered the question properly. I'm not sure if it did, but I'm available for more follow-up after.
Okay, sounds good. There's another question in the chat box, in the Q&A box, from Jody Krakowski. She asks, for the fuel risk evaluation you did, how did you decide what variables to use compared to the standard wildfire model?
Yeah, we spent a lot of time on this and tried a lot of different iterations, and I don't want to make it sound like we didn't pay any regard to the provincial level models or the science. We did, and the direction I got from the local fire center was, yeah, it's not great, and that's all we got, kind of thing. And be careful with modeling, garbage in, garbage out. So we didn't want to put garbage in. So what we did, here's where the local knowledge of the land and seeing how the fire burned in 2017, for example, how it burned, where it burned. I was actually on the fire, so I could see that. I could talk to other people. We know that pine on steep slopes that's dead burns like crazy, obviously. Moist sites lower in the valley, Douglas fir cedar type, doesn't burn with the same intensity. So we essentially used, our main inputs were the forest cover, the species composition, slopes, aspects and percentage of dead species. And the slope and aspect, it was actually, we used the drought mapping that we'd already built for the drought risk, for the drought probability, and we bolted that in. So it was a customized thing, and we kept checking it against what I actually knew to be the case on the ground to refine it and to get as close as we could to what we thought was reasonable. I find that other people who work with risk modeling tend to have to play around a lot with the models to try to make them seem realistic. And I would just be wary in general of accepting that we've only got these two models, so we're just going to use them. I would be wary of accepting that and putting out maps that look like you know what you're talking about, when sometimes those maps are just completely, they're just off, they're way off. So you have to be explicit about those realities. And we did try to use the LIDAR. I didn't even mention our LIDAR mapping. Our initial idea was to use the LIDAR mapping that we had to map the density of the understory, cedar and hemlock and others. Unfortunately, the LIDAR quality was not good enough to penetrate the canopy to do that. So we had to go to Plan B. So a lot of it had to do with looking, trying to get a handle on the understory fuels. Very hard in our case. So if we had better base data, we could do better modeling.
Okay, sounds good. So yeah, that was our final question in the Q&A. Are there any final questions and comments before we wrap things up from anyone? Okay, and if there are any further questions, you can follow up by email. We'll send a follow-up email with all Eric's information, and we can post them in the chat as well. So we'd like to thank everyone for joining us today in this webinar. We hope you found it valuable. As I said, this presentation is recorded, so we'll send out a recording to everybody registered and post it also on our online space for future viewing. And at the end of this webinar, we'll find that there's a short survey just to give us feedback about this webinar and your thoughts and welcome ideas for future webinars. So we'd appreciate it if you could just take some time to do that. I'd like to extend a very big thank you to Eric for your time and your effort and for a great and very informative presentation. And we hope to see everybody in the online platform and stay tuned for future network events as well. Thank you.
Thanks, Eric.
Thank you. Talk to everybody later.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.